I'd like to call the city council meeting to order for September 13, 2011. Before we rise to pledge allegiance, I would like to take time out. Sunday was 9/11. I'd like to take a moment of silence for all the civilians and the firefighters and the police officers that got killed in the line of duty for that day. Thank you. Let's please rise and pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I would like to have a motion to excuse Councilwoman McCarthy.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor, supported by Councilman Masano. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. She is excused. Next item is presentation and proclamations to the Elizabeth Bename Chapter of the National Society of the Daughters of the American Revolution, honoring the Constitutional Week, September 17th to the 23rd. And Ms. Jane May, please join me down by the podium.
This is an annual event that we do here, and it's Constitution Week, where September 17, 2011 marks the 224th anniversary of the drafting of the Constitution of the United States by the Constitutional Convention. As whereas it is fitting and proper to accord official resignation to this magnificent document and its memorable anniversary, and to the patriotic celebration which will commemorate the occasion. And whereas Public Law 915 guarantees the issuing of a proclamation each year by the President of the United States of America, designated September 3rd, 17th through 23rd as Constitution Week. Now, therefore, the Mayor and City Council of Roseville, who hereby proclaim the week of September 17th through the 23rd as Constitution Week, and we ask our citizens to reaffirm their ideas of the framers of the Constitutional Era, 1787, by vigilantly protecting the freedom guaranteed to us through this guardian of our liberties and memory that lost right can never be regained. Ms. May, on behalf of the council, I'd like to ask you again, there's a few words you'd like to say.
I'd like to thank the council and the mayor for the proclamation. Just this week, we showed tribute to the people that survived the 9/11, and next week is Constitution Week, and in the middle of all this, my sister Saturday is having her memorial service. My sister loved God and her country, and I would just say, God, please give, let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with I, we, the people of the United States. And God bless the city of Roseville. God bless you, the people, and God bless America. Thank you.
Our next item is routine approval. Request of minutes for regular meeting held August 23rd, 2011.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Masano, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty. Is there any discussion on the minutes? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request approval of minutes of special joint meeting between the Roseville Community Schools and the Roseville City Council held August 25th, 2011.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman Hagerty, supported by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor. Is there any discussion on the minutes? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is approval of disbursement list.
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Shoemaker, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty. Is there any discussion on the disbursement list this evening? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Mr. Clerk, do we have any correspondence this evening?
I have no actual correspondence, but I would like to state for the public that the absentee ballot applications have been mailed out for anybody not available, will not be in town or available or over the age of 60 to vote in the upcoming November election. So anybody that normally would have received it, possibly did not, or is in need of one, you can contact my office and we can make those arrangements without any trouble.
Thank you. Next item is the hearing of the public agenda items only. Public comment on agenda items only will be heard at the first hearing. Upon approaching the podium, please state your name and address, address the chair, and welcome to direct questions, input information, and/or express opinions to the council. Anyone using inappropriate language will be called out of order and will correct their language or leave the podium. Limit your remarks not to exceed 3 minutes. Anyone not adhering to these rules will be called out of order by the chair. Does anybody wish to be heard on agenda items only this evening? Anybody wish to be heard on agenda items only this evening? Seeing none, we'll go into new business. Request from the Give a Gift Foundation to solicit donation on City Street September 29th through October 2nd. Proceeds to benefit cancer patients. Michael McDowell, petitioner. Is Mr. McDowell in the audience?
Good evening, council. My name is Christina Krupa. My address is 12145 Lutz Avenue, Warren, Michigan. And I'm here, I'm the vice president of the Give a Gift Foundation on behalf of the foundation.
Is there anything you want to add to your petition?
No.
Okay. Are there any questions by council regarding this event? Mayor Pro Tem?
The people that you're going to have out here collecting these funds, they work with your association? Is that what they do? I mean,
That's correct.
Okay, they're not out there because they're ordered by the court or
No.
any community service or anything like that?
No.
Okay.
Not at all. They work for our foundation for us.
Okay.
So any other questions? Sam?
Is there any particular cancer foundation that you give the money to? How do you identify which, generally you say cancer patients, how do you identify who's going to get the money that people donate?
Well, we're a little different than, like, say, the Breast Cancer Foundation, and it's kind of hard to get our name out there to people. We've been trying. We're probably getting close to about being 2 years new. It's our own foundation, and we help patients with any type of cancer. So anybody can come to us, call our foundation, and we will help them with whatever needs. We do have housing, prescriptions, food, and things of that nature, like their everyday needs. So what they do is they go to our website, or sometimes people get a card off the streets from our people who are collecting donations. They call us and say, you know, for example, my aunt has cancer, and, you know, can you give her a hand? We bring them in. I meet with them personally myself. We interview them on their needs, and if they fit our criteria, then we're able to help them, and the money comes directly from our foundation to their hands.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Ma'am, are you located in Roseville?
Yes, we are.
Where at? What's your address in Roseville? Do you know it?
I think it's top of my head. 28351. Thank you. Something I haven't memorized yet.
Okay. 28351.
Gratiot.
Gratiot. Okay. Thank you. Are there any other questions? Seeing none, what are the wishes of the council?
Thank you very much for letting us come to your city.
Thank you
very much.
Motion to approve.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Masano, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty. Is there any discussion on the motions? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request from the Roseville Goodfellows to conduct the No Kitty Without a Christmas campaign on the city streets November 25th through 26th with the inclement weather dates of December 2nd and 3rd, 2011. Ed Young, petitioner. Mr. Young. It's good to see you this evening, sir.
Thank you. Just don't want you to come down when I get done and give me a kiss like you did somebody else. My name is Edward Young, Sr. I'm president of the Roseville Goodfellows. Our address is Post Box 202, Roseville, Michigan. I'm here this evening to try and get the approval from the mayor and city council to have our 80th year Goodfellow paper sale on the streets in the city of Roseville.
Are there any questions for Mr. Young this evening? Mayor Pro Tem Taylor.
Mr. Young, a little concerned about this inclement weather. It's usually always cold out there, and the days were out there anyway. You mean if it snows, rains?
What we mean is if we're worried about it, your face gets too red.
Okay. That's all I have, Mr. Mayor.
Are there any other questions? What's the wishes of the council?
I'd like to make the motion to approve.
Support.
Motion by Mayor Pro Taylor to approve the request, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty. Is there any discussion on the motion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Good luck, sir.
I thank you. If I could, I'm sorry, just 1 minute.
Sure.
Last year, we were able to help 126 families, 257 children, and 13 senior citizens.
And you do a fine job at that, sir. Next item is request reappointment of Emily Snyder to the Millennial Mayor's Conference. Mr. Truman.
Ms. Snyder is here, Mayor. As you know, Councilman Masano is the council's representative to that association. Ms. Snyder is the millennial who is between the age of 18 and 35. Right? That's good enough, right?
Yeah.
Somewhere in that spot. That's what you have to be a millennial. And that has been started through the Michigan Suburbs Alliance. Emily's been a great member of that board. We're requesting that she be reappointed to that position. I think Emily has a report tonight to give council on the status of some of the projects.
Emily Snyder, 2564 Lexington Lane. I am the millennial representative from Roseville on the Millennial Mayor's Congress. The Millennial Mayor's Congress, a partnership of city officials and talented young residents from 23 communities across Metro Detroit, has undertaken a regional visioning initiative. So over the past year, we have conducted a survey and a series of focus groups to better understand the desires and priorities of Metro Detroit millennials. Millennials is the term, as Mr. Truman said, used to describe about 18 to 35-year-olds. And on average, the member cities of the Congress have lost 9.7% of their population between the ages of 20 and 34 from 2000 to 2010, as compared to an overall population loss of 5.8%. So to attract and retain this important group of talented and motivated residents, Roseville must take deliberate action towards the future described by the region's young residents. And so from the survey and focus groups, the Congress was able to pinpoint key areas that attract millennials to a region and develop a vision. And this vision includes economic development, so jobs are still key to attracting young talent, vibrant places, millennials place high value on dense, vibrant downtowns, and Roseville should actively develop and showcase its unique character. Transportation, millennials want a comprehensive transportation system that allows them multiple options to travel between home, work, amenities, fun activities, and regional destinations. Education, millennials see schools as community anchors. Environment, local millennials value recreation opportunities and natural beauty, and Roseville did implement the Congress's 2009 Energy Protocol. And government, millennials want government that is efficient, accessible, and responsive, and Roseville can do this by reaching out to millennials who are eager to work for positive change in their home communities. So I recently met with Councilman Maizano and Valerie from the Suburbs Alliance to narrow this vision in Roseville and what our next steps should be. We focused on three key areas, the first being vibrant places such as developing a downtown area, environment by providing more parks and outdoor recreation areas for millennials and the younger generations, and transportation, connecting Roseville to neighboring communities. And I do have copies of those reports if anyone is interested in them. And over the next 3 to 4 months, the Congress will be gathering public opinion on its regional vision, creating reports that outline possible courses of action on these issues, which is what I have. And in December, adopting a resolution in support of this vision. At this December meeting, the Congress will also decide its next initiative. So Mayor and Council, I ask you to reappoint me as the Roseville Millennial Representative to the Millennial Mayor's Congress for another year so that we can further our relationship with other governmental officials and young people on the Congress and continue to make positive regional change.
Ms. Snyder, thank you very much. I express my gratitude for your dedication and service, because this is a position that we don't pay. And you've done a fine job along with your mentor, Councilman Masano. You've done really, really a good job. At this point, what are the wishes of the council, or does the council have any questions?
Motion to approve.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Masano, supported by Councilwoman Hagerty, to reappoint Emily Snyder to the Millennial Mayor's Congress. That's worse than the Elizabeth Benamé chapter sometimes to me when I'm speaking, so I get tongue-tied. But anyways, is there any discussion on the motion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Good luck, Ms. Snyder, in the next year. Next item is request to set public hearing date in connection with application to create an industrial facilities exemption certificate for Wolverine Plating Corporation, 29456 Grosbeck Highway. Mr. Truman.
Thank you, Mayor. You have an IFT request in front of you from Wolverine Plating Corporation. Wolverine Plating has an existing IFT from years ago, therefore the district has already been established. The request tonight is to set the public hearing date for the night that the council would hear the request itself. For the public's information and council's, this is a proposed project for an investment of $478,330. Included in that is a 2,700 square foot addition to the facility. The current employee count with the facility is 40. The application that you have in front of you shows another 5 being hired. I have requested that the company be at next week's special meeting next week, or our study session on the agenda. If any, there's any additional questions the council may have. As always, your council is invited to visit the site and the facility if there's anything that you'd like to see prior to that time. We have put in the paper, which is unusual, but given the tight time frames this time of year for IFTs, we have put in the paper public notice of the date in 2 weeks. If council at that time is not obligated for approval by any stretch by us doing that, but due to the constraints of the newspapers and getting the IFT in, we were able to get the 14-day requirement taken care of by putting it in there. So the request tonight is just to establish it as an agenda item at the next meeting with a public hearing. That would be September the 26th, or 27th, excuse me, 27th, and on the 20th next week we will have, and during the study session, also representatives from the company here to talk on the issue itself more specifically. You will also receive prior to that time, as you always do and always request, from the assessing department, a breakdown on the taxes that would be abated. I can't tell you if it was a 12-year abatement, which given the size of this, more than likely the recommendation would be for less than that. The total taxes would be $21,106.26 over the 12 years, which means the half abatement, or the half that would be abated, because the other half we do get, would be $10,666. And some change on the two type requests. Thank you.
Are there any questions for Mr. Truman regarding this item? Seeing none, what are the wishes of the council?
Mr. Mayor, I'll make the motion to set the public hearing date, would it be September 20th? Is that what it is?
September 27th.
September 27th for Wolverine Plating Corporation.
Support.
I got a Mayor Pro Tem made the motion to set the public hearing date September 27, 2011, supported by Councilman Ayudo. Is there any discussion on the motion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request award of bidding for pavement marking. Mr. Truman.
Mayor, this is a rather limited request at all times. There's not many companies that do that in the area. Invitation to bid was sent to the two companies. Both companies did respond. The low bid meeting specifications was submitted by PK Contracting in the amount of $13,615. An option A is included in the event that work has to be done on grinding of the previously painted lines. Option B has also an option, an alternate as it relates to turn arrows, a number that may have to be put in. Brings the total cost of the project to $14,965. We've done business with PK Construction in the past. The money for this comes out of local roads and is within budget. Thank you.
Are there any questions for Mr. Truman regarding this item? Seeing none, what are the wishes of the council?
Motion to approve.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman Hager to approve the request of the awarding of the bid, supported by Councilman Ayudo. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is request closed-door session to discuss personnel updates. Mr. Truman.
Mayor, I have the status of the remaining union negotiations to discuss with council, as well as three personnel issues to give them an update on what has been done with those. Thank you.
Okay, can I get a motion here?
So moved.
Support. Motion by Councilman Ayudo, supported by Councilman Masano, go into closed-door session. Mr. Clerk, can we have a roll call vote, please?
Councilwoman Hagerty?
Yes.
Councilman Shoemaker?
Yes.
Councilman Masano?
Yes.
Councilman Ayudo?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Taylor?
Yes.
Mayor Turgeon?
Yes.
To show Councilwoman McCartney absent, 6 positive votes. Mayor, the motion carries.
Okay, thank you. Next item is appointments, and I have a few this evening. These are appointed by council and confirmed by, or appointed by mayor and confirmed by council. On the Beautification Commission, term expires 9/12/11. Alma Jamros, Rita Wilson, Janice Carter, and Judith Ganau. Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilwoman Hagerty, supported by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor, to reappoint Beautification Commissioners. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Next item is I would like to appoint Edward Schaffenstein to the Elected Officials Compensation Board. His term expires on October 1st. So can I have a motion for that?
So moved.
Support.
Motion by Councilman Ayudo, supported by Mayor Pro Tem Taylor. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. That's all the appointments I have this evening. Reports of City Manager, Mr. Truman.
Thank you, Mayor. Mayor, on August 9th, you remember we had a presentation from Better Buildings for Michigan regarding the neighborhood boundaries of Gratiot Avenue, Martin Road, I-696, and I-94. A little bit that's not included in that, and you have maps to that effect. The Better Buildings for Michigans will host the kickoff event on September 28th at 6 p.m. at the Recreation Center at 18185 Sycamore for their residential energy efficiency program for those individuals in that area that are eligible. The letters on that did go out today under the signature of myself and Mr. Connors, our Community Development Director. The neighborhood selected is in the area of the Recreation Center, and that's why we've chosen that for the location of the meeting. To find out if your home is eligible or if you have questions about the program, please contact the outreach team at 866-402-1061. And also, this will have the web page and the cable up to date on this, so people who have interest in that area can contact them. Teens in the 13 to 18 years of age get to get their geek on at the library. I'm just reading these things, by the way. The library sent them to me. Teens can pick up a Geek the Library entry form at the youth desk now through October 31st, and they can tell us what gets them geeked about the Roseville Public Library. Four winners will receive prizes. This is a program that is funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and for more information, you should please contact the library at 445-5407. At our last meeting, a resident came up with a discussion regarding Tuscan Shores and door locks. We have finally been able to contact the management company, and we have a meeting set up with them Thursday, Chief Packlin, myself. These are different individuals than we met with previously. We're a little disappointed that this change took place and we did not know about it. So we're going to be kind of at square one. We will keep council advised what the status is of that meeting, what we find out. As you'll recall, one of the concerns that was brought forth by the resident was about the door system there, the intercom system, and somehow she appeared to be under the impression that the city could A, either had been prohibiting them from doing that, which is not true, or B, could make them do that, which is equally not true. But we will have a conversation to find out what the future plans are as it relates to security in that facility and report back to council on that. And Mayor, that's all I have this evening.
Thank you. Are there any questions for City Manager this evening? Seeing none, we'll move on to reports of City Attorney.
Mayor, I only have one matter to report on. A few weeks back, a couple of residents had an issue with regard to one of the homes located on 12 Mile Road. That has been processed through the court system. The defendant did plead guilty to the junk and debris issues, and the court has set a review hearing for compliance within 30 days, which I think is set to expire this coming Thursday. I believe we have a hearing on that date. So the case is in the process. I do know you may have received some emails, I'm not sure, in the interim about some ongoings with this neighbor, but we are doing whatever we can within the power with the court to try to resolve those issues as best possible for all those affected. Other than that, I have nothing further to report on. Happy to answer any questions you may have.
Are there any questions for Mr. Tomlinson this evening? Councilman Anderson.
Mr. Tomlinson, as far as the 12 Mile resident goes, mm-hmm. they went through the process of the city giving them a violation. They had a certain amount of time to clean up. They didn't clean up. Then it moved on to the court, and then we issued the ability to move forward with that. Mm-hmm. And the court then said, okay, now you have X amount of days to clean up, and if they have or haven't, the court will take action.
But regardless, the court will take some type of action, but the court, prior to rendering a final sentence, wanted to give that individual an opportunity to comply with the request of the city, and has done so. The actual sentencing date, I believe, is this coming Thursday. And we'll have our court, we'll have our code enforcement officers present as well as myself there.
Thank you.
Mr. Thompson, going on that premise, if they don't have their premises cleaned up by that date, what happens then?
Anything it could be up to and including incarceration. I have seen Judge Santia do that with a number of individuals who will continue to violate codes within the city.
Okay, will the court order somebody to clean that residence up, though?
It's something that we would request opportunity to do, I'm sure.
Okay. All right, are there any other questions for Mr. Thomas? Seeing none, we'll move into the second hearing of the public. The second hearing of the public will be for any city business. Upon approaching the podium, please state your name and address. Address the chair. You're welcome to direct questions, input information, and or express opinions to the council. Anyone using inappropriate language will be called out of order and will correct their language or leave the podium. Limit your remarks not to exceed 3 minutes. Anyone not adhering to these rules will be called out of order by the chair. Yes, sir.
How you doing? James Goldwater, 19346 Brandt, Roseville, Michigan. You accused me at the last meeting of lying and playing politics, but there you can see in front of you the millage rate for all the cities I was mentioning. City of Sterling Heights has a 12.69 mills compared to Roseville's 22.38 currently. So we're almost double what they are. I guess we're twice as good as Sterling Heights as they. We got twice the city they do, but I don't know, we're paying twice as much. But you accuse me of lying and playing politics. It seems that every election year, you use your chief of police to throw me out of meetings. And it's only around election time, so I don't know who's playing politics. As far as lying through the teeth, I spoke about the senior center. I said it shouldn't have been built, and when it was, that you would come back and say without a tax increase, it would be closed down. That was true. I said you should have put it at the rec center and to begin with, and you said that would never happen. That's a jewel of the city, and that was true. So what is this and that I'm lying about? Maybe you could explain to the citizens exactly what I'm lying about. But I mean, I don't see any lies in it. I wanted to speak about the recreation merging with East Point. I know right now our director currently makes around $90,000 a year and gets a city car. I know when the government bailed out GM and Chrysler's, their new workers only made half of what they make now. They're at about $14, $16 an hour. I was wondering if we merge all these, are you gonna have three directors? And are you gonna cut that director's pay in half and take away his company car like most people do in a bailout or what have you to show good faith to the citizens? If not, if that guy doesn't want to take that cut, I'll guarantee there's a lot of people coming out of college right now that got just as many degrees as he does in recreation and all that that could run that center, and they'd be more than happy to do it for about $45,000 to $50,000 a year. But I guess that doesn't fall into play. And it's also funny to hear you guys talk about putting an addition on the rec center that you can't afford to keep right now without a millage. It's instead of maintaining what we have, you want to go out and spend more and do more. As far as people using the rec center, you're asking about 98% of the residents to pay for 2% that use it. Now, the rec department is a great thing, and I don't want to see it leave the city. But you tell me how many kids you know by 14 Mile Road in Kelly that are going to drive their bikes over to, or walk over to 11 Mile in Gratiot. They talked about kids would go crazy and start doing vandalism. No, maybe your kids would, but mine won't. I bring them upright. And they can play basketball in their yard, or you got Michigan youth football, you got Roseville, has got a football league, they got wrestling leagues. That the people that can afford to pay for it, they can get their kids in it. The people that don't shouldn't have to pay for everybody else's in these hard economic times. So maybe you can.
Sir, I'd ask you to conclude your remarks.
Okay, and one other thing, I guess it's fair for other people to talk out of the audience to you and not me, and that's how you got me ejected, but I'm sure everybody in the audience sees that. So good luck to you.
Let me say this about your ejection. Frank Masano had the floor that evening and he was explaining something. Oh, I'm sorry, sir, you can sit down now if you like.
What's that?
You can sit down. I'm not going to debate you.
Okay.
Okay. So anyways, she was concerned about the little kid that got shot. You in the back were making political catcalls. That's why you were ejected. Now, let's get into your chart here. Sir, that's enough. I'm not going to debate you. Now, let's get to your chart here with the mean average of the homes. You say that Sterling Heights, and I'm going to use them, they play 2.69%. Mr. Goldwater, you can have a seat now.
Oh, I thought
it's my turn to talk now.
Oh, okay. That way you can spin it your way. Okay.
Okay.
Maybe you can put this on the website for everybody to see.
It's 12.69% taxes they pay. You don't come up here and say what the mean average of the house in Sterling Heights costs. Is it 100,000? Is it 200,000? Our houses have been chopped in half. That's why there's a big difference here, and that's why we pay less taxes than we do. As far as the districts, the add-on to the gym, we're making it bigger for the seniors and for the kids. And if you recall, and Mr. Truman, if I'm wrong, tell me. If the millage goes through, we will do that. Am I correct?
We have baked that into the equation for the budget for the authority. When they have that in front of them, that has been baked into the budget, the improvement on the building and in addition to it to make it more friendly, senior friendly on some of the things that we found that it doesn't meet. Fitness room, computer room, there's a number of objects. And while we're doing that, since we have to make that repair on the walls, we think it makes more sense to do the addition while we're doing that.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else from the public wish to be heard this evening?
Hello. Hello, hello. Edward Strauss, 28305 Gratiot, Roseville, Michigan. I'm here to announce our annual open house at Gonzo Art Studio. We provide a service to the community through the arts. And on Sunday nights, we have an open mic that I allow students, seniors, people of all ages to come in and express themselves through art, music, and poetry. Recently, someone complained about the art studio looking like an art studio, and the building inspector and the fire inspector came to the studio. They were quite polite, and they looked around, and they seen everything was in order, but they noticed the windows were in need of repair. The windows actually date back to, turn of last century. And what we plan to do here to raise funds to put the new windows in to abide by the city's demands, you want to say, is I'm painting roses on the mural, and you're able for $10 dedicate a rose to you, and underneath it by 1-inch number, or you can put a number on like a birthday to a loved one. The city says I cannot put letters on my building, but numbers are not letters. And this is what we plan to do. Help us raise money to get new windows to make the area look nicer. This Sunday, this is going to be this Sunday. We're doing it Friday, Saturday, Sunday. It's a three-day art festival. And Sunday, we're having a memorial service to the homeless man that died on Utica Road. We don't know who he is yet, but I have an inkling because I haven't seen this person for a while. They are human beings and they need to be respected. Their lives are just as precious as ours. It is election year, and I hope everyone behaves themselves up there and respect that we are the citizens. We pay your wages. Without us, you wouldn't be driving Cadillacs. I drive a bicycle, and I'm proud to drive my bicycle. And I have been kicked out of these meetings before, not very nicely, just because I had an opinion. If you give us proper time to speak up here, we won't have to go back here and shout it. Okay, you guys have a good day. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else from the public wish to be heard? Yes, sir.
Terry Rigenthaler, 25801 Wiseman. About the mill that's on the ballot. Last meeting, you guys approved the bill for the library. That's fine. If you'd have trusted us, that one would have got passed in November anyhow. We didn't trust us. Now, we're supposed to trust you about this one bill. And in reading all about it and looking at it, I mean, it's going to generate $1.5 million. $1 million from Roseville, $500,000 from East Point. We didn't even make the numbers equitable between the two cities. We didn't go a half million or 500,000 and 500,000. We went a million here and 500,000 there. We could have done a half mil and equaled the same thing and come up with a million. And now, what we're not saying on the ballot is we're wrapping this thing up in a public act. And I saw it happen with public acts. When they come down, because there's an additional two mills that authority can request. It's right in there. If they need money for this or need money for that, they can ask for two mills over a five-year period. Now we're up to $4.5 million a year. But the point of being is we're wrapping it up in a public act, and I saw how a public act works at the last meeting. Yes, it says that the voters should vote on it, but it's a double-edged sword, isn't it? Voters don't have to vote on it if it's under a public act. You guys can give us two mills. So what scares me is I got my government looking at me saying, trust me. Thank you.
Mr. Tomlinson, as far as that, under Public Act 64, we cannot ask for two mills.
Under which act are we talking
public
about?
Act
the library?
164, yeah.
The library, you can only go up one mill. It has to go to the voters for any additional mill.
Right. That's what I thought. So, Mr. Mergenthaler, if we want to increase the millage, we have to go to the voters after that. Anybody else from the public wish to be heard this evening? Yes, sir.
Roland Snodgrass, 19237 12 Mile. In reference to the neighbor, Mr. Bachman that lives next door that Mr. Tomlinson was talking to, I was in court that day with him, okay? I think tomorrow is 30 days. She has not removed anything from her property. She has hauled in five more carloads of stuff, okay? The only way we're going to clean this problem out is bring a dumpster out in the front yard and get somebody to empty it. There is no way that she needs what she has in the backyard when all of it was curbside treasures. So, us neighbors, we want our property value back. And however we have to do, we're going to get it back. We have been very patient. I think this is like 5 years that we have been fighting with this. And in 2 weeks, we're inviting the troubleshooters from the TV stations. We don't want to do it, but we think that's our next step in getting some results. We don't want to have to go to litigation to try to recover what we've lost in our property. We need to get something done before the fall is here. Then we start covering everything up with tarps, and then all the rodents and the varmints still have a better place to hide than they've got now. We're getting the squirrels back. I don't know if they're going in her yard, but where I used to see one a day or something, I'm seeing five following each other. But they go in that tree there, and I don't know whether they're there or not. So But we've got to get this cleared up. It's not going to go away. We're here to stay. So we need to get ourselves together. I can't cut my grass on that side of the house if the door is open or her air conditioner's running, because I can't breathe. That's what comes out of the house. You know, I don't know how long you expect us as neighbors to live with this, you know? But I would like to see something happen. We don't want to have to go where we're fixing to go, so. I love this city. I've been here many years, and I want to stay here. And the only way I'm going to leave is, depends on what Snyder does in January on my pension, is how much money he wants to take out of it. So whenever we take everything into consideration, let's work to get this cleaned up. One other thought. When you're thinking of the rec center, I would think about how many senior citizens that's going to go south of here come January when Mr. Snyder starts doing his thing. So thank you very kindly.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Tomlinson, is at this hearing, is it open to the public if the neighbors want to come?
Sure, and I think they're aware of that, that they're invited to be there.
Okay, what judge is it in front
of? Judge Santia.
Okay, all right. Sir.
Dan Latham, 24635 Marine, East Palm, Michigan. I have more of a general question for the council, maybe the legal staff. I notice we're spending a lot of time on properties that need to be cleaned up, both in East Point and in Roosevelt. And I'm wondering if there's a way that the city can go back and recoup the costs spent for the attorney fees, for the building department fees, all the time that's being processed, just like we do with inmates. Charge them for that time when they're found guilty or in violation of the law, to recoup some of those costs to the cities.
Okay. Well, I'm pretty sure that once we do a cleanup on a property, sir, it's put on a tax lien, and whenever they sell the house, the money has to come back to the city. Correct, Mr. Thomas?
That is true, Mayor. Wherever we can obtain reimbursement for costs and expenses incurred by either city personnel, our office, we do so. But for each of those items, there has to be statutory authority to do so. So for instance, drunk drivings, there's a statute that says we can seek cost recovery for any time our officers spend on that. If there's not specific authorization, we can't collect for that. For instance, prosecution of code violations, there's not authorization from the state of Michigan to allow us to impose those type of fines and costs. With regard to the demolition costs, there is authorization under the statutes to do so, and of course, that's exactly what we do. We charge back the homeowner, and if they fail to pay, we place a lien on the property.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else from the public wish to be heard this evening? Yes, sir.
Hi, Jim Gallagher, 17751 12 Mile Road, Roseville. My concern is dogs running loose and menacing residents in a neighborhood. I realize we have animal control, but dogs don't punch out at 4 o'clock. They run loose constantly. Today, I had a woman turn a dog loose just before I came to the meeting. She turned her dog loose on a squirrel in my yard. The squirrel was attacked. Now it's gonna die. I mean, it's injured, but it's a nonstop problem. I've been menaced by my neighbor's dogs. Mr. Sipes is aware of it. The police were called, but these dogs are running 24/7, 7 days a week. Is there anything we can do to get animal control to respond 24/7? They don't punch out at 4 o'clock.
Well, I know, sir, but you can't.
Animal control should be on call.
You can call the police department and they will notify Mr. Mm-hmm. Sipes. Mr. Truman.
Mr. Thomas will respond to this, Mr. Mayor.
Pardon?
Mr. Thomas will respond to this.
Well, it becomes difficult to have animal control 24/7, as you can imagine. We try our best to have them available whenever possible. However, there is another option. If you're continuing to have problems with the dog running on the loose, you can make a police report to that effect. And if you wish to proceed with charges against that individual, you would make an appointment with my office. We usually hold them at 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock on Thursdays. You call the court, they're in district court, give them the incident report number, come and see me, and we'll talk about bringing charges against that individual. And the best thing is, of course, to have witnesses and verifiable evidence other than just he said, she said type of scenario.
Some of my neighbors have seen these dogs come after me, and I can't get out of their way, and she can't get out of their way.
And that's a perfect example where you should make a police report, and we would follow it through in that fashion. Okay?
So please call the police next time that happens.
I have called the police. They stayed in the driveway at 1 o'clock in the morning and blew their sirens trying to wake the people up in their house. But it woke up the whole neighborhood, and they weren't even home.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Anybody else from the public wish to be heard this evening? Yes, sir.
Good evening. Dave Chesney, 304-40 Normal, Roseville, Michigan, member of the Roseville Neighborhood Watch. I want to bring some information to you guys. Last night we had our Neighborhood Watch meeting, and one of the gals from the city manager's office happened to be there. She could testify to this. We're getting a lot of complaints about rental property and the shady characters that are moving into these places. You know, one thing the city of Roseville, East Point, and all the cities got to do, you know, if we can work together on a parks and recreation issue, we got to get control of this rental property, and we got to try to get back to owner-occupant. I'm an owner-occupant, and I'm proud of my home, and I'm proud to live in Roseville. But I'm going to tell you, broker landlords have pretty much destroyed every good neighborhood in Detroit. You know, down there 7 Mile and Kelly, for example, 10, 15 years ago, used to be a nice neighborhood. The owner of those broker landlords, who some of them don't even live in the United States. They got people here that just go out and collect the rent. A lot of it's Section 8. They get paid by the government, you know. And that's what we were discussing at the Neighborhood Watch meeting. You know, it's really starting to get to be a problem in this city. Not just here, but Warren's having problems, East Point, the Shores, everybody. You know, we need to really crack down on rental property. I know you guys are stepped up code enforcement, and I know you said you're working hard to make the right decisions. Well, I tell you, quality of life. Three of our state reps, and I don't like Lansing, but three of our local state representatives, when I asked them about quality of life in the inner ring suburbs, they said absolutely what is happening in Detroit is having an effect on us, and we as residents need to speak up to our local governments. I mean, so I'm saying to my city government, hey, do what you have to do, and let's, you know, clean up this rental property and don't let these broker landlords come in here with their Section 8 riffraff and destroy our city. I feel very strongly about this. You know why? 30 years ago, I was just entering to be a senior in high school, and I'm starting to see the same things happening in this city and the surrounding area that I see near Kelly and Whittier in 1981. It is a serious issue, and we need to really look at it. I thank you guys very much.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else from the public wish to be heard this evening? Anybody else wish to be heard? Seeing none, we'll move into the comments by City Council. Councilman Masano.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. First, I want to thank the ladies at the surgery facility over on 12 Mile and Little Mac, who took care of me this past Thursday, prepared by meniscus. I couldn't pronounce it 2 months ago. Now I know all about it. But the doctor did a remarkable job. I've felt no pain. I feel wonderful. They did a terrific job, and the ladies in the facility were just tremendous. I'd also like to congratulate the Roseville football team. 2-0, 2 wins. They only had 6 points scored. Shut the opponents out in the last game. Coach had a baby daughter just prior to that. What more could you ask for except another win this coming week? So go, Panthers, go. Jane May, what can we say about her receiving an award? She's just a tremendous lady. And I want to say hi to Bev. I want to say hi to Charlie Mason
Haven't seen them in quite a while. I'm glad you're back. Welcome back. That's it, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Councilman Udo.
Thank you, Mayor. Mayor, I have nothing tonight. Just take care of each other. Thank you.
Councilman Shoemaker.
Just a couple of things. Emily Snyder, thanks for the report. Doing a great job, and congratulations on your reappointment. And I'm going to just do a public service announcement. The Roseville Heritage Foundation is throwing a sock hop Saturday, September 24th at the VFW Hall. There'll be DJ, food, beer, pop, and dancing, and tickets are $20. That's September 24th, Saturday from 7 to 11 p.m. at the VFW Hall. That's all I have, Mayor. Thanks.
Thank you. Councilwoman Hagerty.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to congratulate the Daughters of the American Revolution on their Constitution Week. Congratulations, Emily, on your reappointment, and thank you for all your time and hard work that you've put into it. I attended the 9/11 memorial on Sunday, and although it was very solemn, it was quite moving. And I think we all need to take time out and think about those that have given their lives and have lost their lives for our country. I'd like to congratulate the beautification reappointments and Mr. Safferstein, and good luck to the Give a Gift Foundation and to the Goodfellows on their upcoming functions in the city. And that's all I have, Mayor.
Mayor Pro Tem Taylor.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I too would like to congratulate Mr. Young and Mrs. Young there on with the 80th year of the Roseville Goodfellows. I know you guys put a lot of work and effort into it, and I know you're going to have a lot of support from the council. We'll be staying out there with everybody else, and hopefully this year will be better than last year. We try to do that every year, but if anybody out there is willing to volunteer their time, please get a hold of Mr. Young after the meeting, and he'll give you all the information you need, because we could use all the volunteers we could possibly get. Bev and Charlie, good to see you're out and about. I know you've been down a little bit, but it looks like you're getting better. Good time of the year for that. Holidays coming around, and it makes things a lot easier. I too would like to make an announcement. The Roseville Community Fireworks Committee just newly put together. The Fireworks Committee is a committee of members from council and local community members. And what we're doing is we're putting together a committee to, well, we already did put a committee together to put together the fireworks for next year over at Memorial Field. And so because of that, we're going to have our first annual pancake breakfast, and that's going to be October 2nd at St. Athanasius Church, which is at 187-20 13 Mile Road on 13 Mile in Kelly. And tickets are going to be $7 for adults and $5 for children up to 12, and under 5 children will be for free. So if you could come out and help with that, so we could get our fireworks off the ground, and hopefully we could have a really good event coming up in June. I'd like to congratulate all the beautification commissioners on their reappointment to the board. And Emily, congratulations. It sounds like you put an awful lot of time in, and I'm sure it's very rewarding for yourself and everything that you're going to be doing in your future, your political career. I'm sure you're going to have one. And you might be thinking differently by now. I don't know. But on that, I also, too, would like to congratulate the Roseville Panthers. Frank, I think they're 3-0. And they play Henry Ford Friday at 7 o'clock at home. So if you folks can find time to go out and support the Panthers. And also, if you have any children at home that haven't made it to school yet, or if you're looking for a school, please think about attending Roseville Community Schools. We have excellent staff members, and I'm sure it'll definitely help our community. So if you can get the word out on that, that would definitely help everyone involved in Roseville schools. That's all I have, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. I have a couple of things before we go into closed session. First of all, yesterday, departments, fire departments and police departments on Sunday from all over the county came to downtown Mount Clemens to honor our fallen heroes that were killed in the line of duty in the state of Michigan in concert with the 9/11 But anyways, I'd like to thank our Roseville Fire Department and our Police Department. They were looking good and sharp out there. And Bob Wooten, who is a member of the committee, he gave a great speech, and we really appreciate all that they've done. I was also invited to St. Gabriel's Church in East Point for another memorial. I'd like to thank the Reverend Susan Bach for inviting me to her memorial service also in East Point. Emily, it's going to be great to have you back again for another year, and your millennials. I know we're getting ready to get you groomed for a seat up here one of these days. So I know you're laughing, but that's what that's all about. It's to get kids involved in government, to see how their government works, to see the pitfalls and the good things that happen, and you're doing a fine job, and we like that. With that, we're going to close the session.
7:55.